Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the international workshop Writing, Reading, Plays. Just a second, I will take it in hand. I have the honor and the pleasure to welcome here again Helene Sixou and Eric Prenowitz for a conversation about the essay we heard last night, as well as a recent and related play by Helene, both translated by Eric for this occasion. I met Helene and Eric the last time 16 years ago and am deeply grateful for the opportunity to share thought with both of you again on the occasion of this workshop. Over the last years, our group has studied works of your collaboration, in particular the essays My Algerians and Stigmata on your, Helene's, Algerian childhood, which became key to our understanding of the complexities of place and belonging in literature in general, and in Jewish literatures in particular. We are thrilled to follow both of you today in a conversation about questions raised by your more recent text. I will briefly introduce Eric Prenowitz, who will then introduce Helene Sixou to us and open the conversation. Eric Prenowitz teaches literary theoretical cultural studies at the School of Fine Arts at Leeds University. He is also the executive editor of Parallax, an international journal of critical cultural theory. He has published widely on, as well as translated, the works of Helene Sixou and Jacques Derrida. We owe him, among others, the translation of Derrida's Mal d'Archive, Archive Fever, with a fabulous endnote on the translator's task, and the new literary history special volume on Helene Sixou, When the Word is a Stage. In 2011, he edited a collection of essays by Helene Sixou in English translation, Volleys of Humanity. His most recent translation is of Sixou's 2014 book on and with the conceptual artist Adel Abdesemet, Insurrection of Dust. Eric is interested in radical literary performativities, in writing that won't keep still, like that of Helene Sixou, and in the unstable borders between theory or philosophy, thinking, and its others, art, literature, and life. Eric.
Thank you, Caroline. Can you, is this working? Can you hear me? Thank you, Carola. I'm delighted to be here and to have the opportunity to introduce Helene Sixou. Maybe I should come a little closer to this. Helene Sixou was born in Algeria in 1937, which was then a French colony, had been colonized in 1830.
C'est pas assez fort. Her father, personne ne va entendre, tu vois, c'est terrible.
Helene's father was an Algerian Jewish doctor, while her mother was a German Jew born in Osnabrück. In the early 1930s, Helene's mother, Eve, left Nazi Germany and settled in Paris, where she met Helene's father, Georges, who had come from Oran, Algeria, to take the final exams for his degree in medicine. They married in Oran. Helene's maternal grandmother, Omi, escaped from Germany in extremis at the end of 1938 and joined them in Algeria. However, a large portion of Omi's extended family was deported. Helene's father's family had acquired French nationality in 1867, several years before all French Algerian Jews were granted French citizenship by decree. During the war, French Algerian Jews had their French nationality revoked by the collaborationist French Vichy regime, and for 3 years were effectively stateless. Helene's father died in 1948 when she was 10. Her mother later became a midwife, opening a clinic in Algiers to support her young family. Helene grew up in Algeria and only moved to France at the age of 18 to continue her studies. She wrote a PhD on Joyce and very quickly became known as one of the most important thinkers and writers of her generation. She met Jacques Derrida in 1963 when they were both young academics, and they immediately became friends for life, a friendship that produced a rich literary, philosophical, and personal exchange. She has worked very closely with a celebrated theater director, Ariane Mnouchkine, and has been playwright for Mnouchkine Théâtre du Soleil for some 35 years. Indeed, Helene was in Israel, as Carola said last night, with the theater in 1988 when her major play on the partition of India, Landiad, was performed at the Jerusalem Festival. Helen Csiksu has written upwards of 45 books of fiction. They contain the most inventive, unbridled, poetic, and philosophical writing there is. She has also written about a dozen full-length plays and hundreds of critical or theoretical essays. In 1969, after the student riots, she was tasked by the French Minister of Education with establishing a new experimental university. This was to become the University of Paris 8, where she has taught ever since. In 1974, she created there the first French doctoral program in women's studies and the Centre d'études féminines. She has taught her doctoral seminar for over 40 years, training several generations of intellectuals from around the world in the feeble yet overpowering powers of what she once called feminine writing, which is to say writing worthy of the name, the kind of writing she discussed and performed last night. Please welcome me, join me in welcoming Helen Csiksu. If it's okay, I'd like to continue immediately with my first question, because we've prepared a series of Carola and myself written questions, and we thought we would ask two questions at once, almost, to begin with, and then we'll see where we go from there. So maybe I'll start, and your very first book, a full-length fiction, published in 1969, is called Dedans, meaning inside. Already in this book, there is a strong link between writing and violence. The inside is, among other things, the house of your childhood in Algiers. It constitutes a space protected from the violent exterior world, i.e. colonized Algeria. Furthermore, it seems that from the very beginning of your career, your writing itself is a retreat from a violent exterior. Raw, brute violence is in the outside world, not in your world of writing. Is writing for you a space of peace, a refuge separated from a violent world? What is the relation for you between violence and writing, inside and out, or outside and in?
Okay, just a second. I will continue with a second question. Helen, you have shared two texts with us that seem radically different at first sight in terms of genre, voice, authorship, and authority. The first, IA, The Shout of Literature, which we heard last night, which is a text of poetic theory about literature, writing, and violence. And the second text, Oi, perhaps best understood as a Kammerspiel, Machazeh Kamari, in Hebrew, with two characters, Selma and Jenny Meyer, debating a problem or conflict in their everyday lives, namely their recent return to Osnabrück, their birthplace. At the same time, and in spite of this difference, strong difference between these two texts, there are palpable links or mutual metamorphoses between these two texts, from the exclamation marks in the titles to the imaginative interplays of French, German, and English in both texts, the occupation with native lands of violence, of writing and literature in Ayai, of Selma and Jenny in Oi, and with a place, I quote, always the same place that is haunted, the bedchamber or the chamber of crime in IA, always above the family dining room, and the kitchen in Oi. What divides and what connects these two texts in your eyes?
Tu veux prendre la main?
Je sais pas. Est-ce que...
Non, je crois pas. Je non. crois que c'est ça.
Ah, je dois prendre. Ouais. Ah,
peut-être tu peux prendre ça.
Attends, est-ce que je vais, c'est mieux de ce côté alors. Ok, pardon, excusez-moi. I felt before we started that it would be wise to be questioned from both sides, and also from both gender, sexes, incarnations, etc., etc. Simply because probably the secret structure of everything I do, write, experience, think about, has to do with division, a theme which I'm sure you're all familiar with. Division between inside and outside. a division which is not opposition, as Eric pointed, my first pseudo-novel, because it wasn't a novel. It was the type of fiction I write. Was called dedans, that is inside. Of course, you cannot imagine anything inside without outside. And of course, again, you cannot really decide whether inside is inside or outside. My first experiences as a child, that were my primal scenes, when I was three in Oran, in Algeria, which was the scene, a stage of multiple hostilities, racisms, hatreds, had to do with the fact that I never knew whether I was inside or outside. I was trying all the time to go inside what, this is another question, inside the world, or inside the garden, inside others. And when I thought, with my powerful soul of 3 years old, that I had succeeded in being admitted inside, I had never been as much as an outsider as I could ever even begin to feel. So this is one of the themes, which is at the same time, I think, really a root theme. Why do I say that today? I do realize it's Israel, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, Yerushalayim, etc., etc. I mean, that they prompt probably, or they revive this wound in me very strongly, as if I didn't know. I don't know really. I have a feeling. This morning, for instance, Carola told me that the muezzin was singing. I thought I was in Algeria, you know, but I was still asleep, and I thought, well, I can bear that, because this is the song, it's the Arab song I used to hear in my childhood. I didn't realize it was the muezzin, nor, you know. So, I, as you who were there yesterday have realized, is simply a hymn to literature as being the, not the house, maybe the field for the shout. Which is why I practice literature, because I want to shout. Or I want to be silent in a way that is extremely loud. I want loud silence. Ai is also, it's a proper name, which is a wonder. And it has to do with, it is the shout of pain, but the moment pain shouts, it frees itself also of deadly silence. So I do think we need to shout, but we need to shout also in a way that has a form, that has a shape, that becomes a kind of singing. I realize, as in a kind of afterthought, that I've several times written something that shouted silently with an exclamation and exclamation marks, and also cries, ay ay, etc. I didn't do it on purpose, because you know, when you write, you always write the same thing differently. That is, all writers write the same thing. They have written the same passion, the same mourning, or the same joy for 3,000 or 4,000 years. Exactly the same. That's why we can read them, because it's always today, simply differently. So suddenly, I had to accept the fact that I have apparently written several times the same shout. But it's not the same, it's different. For instance, Ayai is a kind of collection, recollection of the genealogy of this shout in literature. Which is, again, it's also, it's it's a justification of literature. But the other piece, which in French is called I, so it's not I, but I, is a bit different, although of course it connects, and of this I want to say a few words. I in French is written A-I-L, and those who are French-speaking will recognize the word. It's in German, Knoblauch. Comment dire en anglais, aïe?
Garlic.
Garlic. Garlic. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So this of course opens, I mean, this simple signifier opens to the whole history of anti-Semitism in Germany and in Poland, of course. I mean, mainly in Europe, but in my family's Germany. So just to make it more explicit, my grandmother, Omi, which means granny, grandmother, etc., in German, and I've realized now that one doesn't say Omi anymore in Germany, one says Oma.
Mm.
So Omi, my grandmother, Rosalie Klein, who actually, because you have the German Kaiser somewhere around, who recited poems in front of Wilhelm, Kaiser Wilhelm, when she was a kid, and who was a native of Osnabrück in Hanover, she would tell me, and she was a very distinguished, ete potete, as one says in idiomatic German, ete potete person. She was very upset that when she was a young woman and she would walk in the beautiful streets of Osnabrück, some Germans would step off, you know, and say, you stink of garlic, you know. I translate, Jew. And she would tell me, I never use garlic, you know, in German. Hmm? No garlic ever in the house. She even had a quarrel with my Spanish grandmother who used garlic. This is a stigmata. Of course, my grandmother didn't know anything about it, but she, for me, it simply introduced in the flesh of my imagination a theatrical scene and a signifier, I, in French, I. Mm. Then when you hurt yourself in French, you shout, I, not in other languages. My grandmother wouldn't say I, although at the end of her life, she maybe gradually came to translating into I, because you would say au. So au in German, au, au, au. So indeed, oi is rather Yiddish, which my grandmother didn't use Yiddish. But of course, in translating, we tried to find a compromise. The story of the two sisters, which is partly real, partly fictitious, the way reality is, deals with a situation which I thought was that of my mother and her relatives, her sister, etc. But I do realize now that I'm repeating the predicament. The two sisters, who are a couple exactly as in En Attendant Godot, that is, a couple that, you know, they cannot disconnect. And at the same time, they quarrel all the time, as my mother and her sister would do for 90 years. They would quarrel all the time, and I would watch these wonderful puppets, you know, quarreling, being in a kind of conflict. And the conflict always, this is of course my reading, it had a kind of general theme, which was both intimate, that is a family theme, but it wasn't at the same time. I think it's a Jewish theme. I can say that here, because I suppose that when I say Jewish here, people understand. if I say that in Paris, I can't. You know, I can't say that in Paris because no one will understand. If I say it's a Jewish theme, no one will know the references, and so the Jewish theme is what I heard as a kind of music all my life. Das soll man nicht sagen. This you mustn't say. You know, what? Don't say anything against the family, because it will hurt the Jews. That is, you recognize? Don't say something, don't say that something bad, a crime. Don't say that a crime has been committed by somebody in the family, or in the enlarged family, the Jewish community, or anything. So stop, hold your mouth, shut up. Don't, it's a law that was, it was a kind of funny music when I was a kid. And at the same time, it was a law, it was forbidding to say something. And it's a kind of prohibition. At the same time, it is a philosophical prohibition, you know, that is. What is, how do you, that's what we have to experience now in France. What are there limits to the freedom of saying the truth or a fact? What kind of limits? Why? Should there be limits? All ethics, philosophy, etc., have to do with that, and particularly, of course, literature, which, as you know, is probably, if it's so vital, it's because it's the place, the without limit, the limit without limit, where one can and one must say everything that one cannot say. It's the place where the place, the it has no frontier, where you can and have the chance to overcome all the prohibitions which enclose communal life, society, etc., etc. The place where we breathe. It can be tragedy. That is, if you have to deal with this impossibility of saying the truth, if there is truth, but I mean, truth doesn't exist, of course. It's divided. The truth is also false, etc., etc. It goes on and on like that. But at least jump into the abyss of truth. So it can be tragedy. See, for instance, Kafka, but it's also a comedy, you know. And as a person, a child and a grown-up, I always felt that these two, tragedy and comedy, were both also quarreling and coming to terms and becoming a kind of a hybrid, which is the tone of literature, a tragic comedy or a comical tragedy, which I cultivate. Dedans, my first so-called novel, which is not a novel, happened inside. I don't think that the outside was Algeria, because I was then young enough. It's very difficult to be young enough, you know. I was young enough to be universal. That is, Algeria for me was the world. I was not referring to Algeria. And I know that now that I'm not young enough, I know that Algeria was simply a perfect metaphor of the world. That is, a world. It was the world as divided, as boiling with violence, with spewing blood all the time, and spittle. And shit, etc. I mean, it was a horrible place where people hurt one another and everybody hurt oneself, of course, because betrayal was everywhere, betrayal of mankind. So you betray yourself too, etc., etc. So, inside the metaphor of Algeria as a world, I had another metaphor, which was the crime in the family. The crime in the family is the root of tragedy. That's Greek. It's the family. It's a king or a queen, and they kill each other, and they kill one another's children, etc., and they eat them, etc., etc. I mean, what happens today, every day? And in my family, there was a crime. The crime was that my father died when I was 10, and everybody had killed him, of course. He had killed himself, my mother had killed him, my grandmother had killed him, his father had killed him, etc. I mean, all this, of course, is what happens in the unconscious. It was not true that the family had killed my father, who was a wonderful man, a just person. But, the family knows that when somebody dies in a way that is not natural, that is unnatural, then he has been killed, or she has been killed. And then the way you treat the dead, the way you behave with the dead, is, of course, essential. And that is the first lesson I was taught by life. The fact that you bury, you bury. Or you unbury. Or you're obscene with death, etc. I mean, all kinds of ways of being unable to face an event that changes your life, that cuts away a piece of your body and your soul, etc. So when I wrote Dedans, it was simply a kind of summary of those tragedies that mirror each other, one being the intimate tragedy, which reflects the exterior outward tragedy. Because of course when in Algeria I kill the Arab and the Arab kills me, I kill my brother and he kills his sister. It's obvious, So that is why I say division is primary. I am you, I am the Arab, and the Arab is me. That's in my childhood. I could never say, for instance, that the French Vichyist, the French fascist, the French collaborationist was me. This I couldn't bring myself to think. But the one who resembles me in the in suffering, I could relate to. I inherited as first inheritance the Algeria of this kind of huge geopolitical entity, which is Europe and North Africa, France and North Africa. But on the other side, with my mother and grandmother, etc., it was Germany and environs, that is all other countries, and Nazism, and the Jews. They look alike with differences. Trying to say everything, that is, to give a voice to each part of to each character in the tragedy, is the mission of the poet. Then, of course, they all quarrel. They all quarrel. I've lived with that quarrelsome spirit in the air all my life, but I don't resent it. I enjoy it because it's human.
Okay, I would like to continue perhaps a bit further in that same direction, and I would like to speak about the way in which Oi, the play, recalls two of your earlier texts of poetic fiction, Osnabrück, from 1999, which actually ends in a kitchen scene, and Benjamin à Montaigne, Il ne faut pas le dire, from 2001, which opens with a kitchen scene of an exceptional violence of voices, shouts really, between again Selma and Yeni. And I would like to quote a sentence from Benjamin à Montaigne, which I think both recalls the talk we heard last night and also what you have just now been saying. I quote and I translate on my own, excuse me please. From the moment they are in the kitchen together, it's always the same country, the native land one cannot denounce, end of quote. Now both of these kitchen scenes, the scene that opens Osnabrück and the scene that ends Osnabrück and the scene that opens Benjamin à Montaigne, both of these kitchen scenes are also scenes of writing, in the sense you elaborate in Aie, the shout of literature. And I would like to follow a sentence which is the last sentence of Osnabrück in order to make that kind of metapoetic perspective more clear. Nous voilà toutes les deux dans la cuisine avec Omi, notre mère dans le récit. Eve épluche les oignons et je verse en torrent de larmes. Eric, could you probably translate? I'm sorry, I should have prepared you for that.
I think you could probably
can
do it yourself.
Oh my
yeah,
God, no.
Go on.
It would be a disaster.
No, do it.
Okay. We are here, both of us, in the kitchen with Omi, our mother, in the story. Is that okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
In the narrative.
In the narrative. Eve mm-hmm. is peeling the onions, and I
shed.
You have a good matter.
I shed.
I shed a flood of tears. Mm. I shed a flood of tears, while of course the French verb verser also recalls verse and verse, so you have that kind of metapoetic feeling in it. And of course the peeling of the onion evokes literature and the kind of biting air of lamentation that it has. Now the same kind of metapoetic idea evolves from the kitchen scene in Benjamin à Montaigne, with the idea of the poetic I quote, the only one in the family to ask this question of birth and birthplace, which is an idea which you also, follows last evening, meaning the only one who is a writer. There are other links between Oi and these two earlier texts of poetic fiction, to which you already alluded in what you just answered in response to Eric's and my questions. You speak about my two chapters, the kitchen drama with big letters at the beginning and the siege of the room in Clos Salambier, the neighborhood in Algiers, where you spent your childhood. And there are perhaps other links that we could explore a bit further. The idea of an invaded authorship, the way in which you are flooded by voices, by figures, by people from the family, from the extended family who appear on the scene of writing when you set out to write, and you have an amazing verb for this kind of authorship. You say, je spec 30 ans. I have a spectral hearing. I hear ghosts, if you like. So maybe could you elaborate a bit further on the kind of metapoetical aspects which are in the kitchen scenes that so abound in your text of fiction and again also in Oi?
Those questions are so rich, you know. They're like beautiful plates with so many attractive types of delicatessen. So to come back to the kitchen theme, because I didn't answer, because it was so rich what you started evoking, I didn't answer the question or regarding la chambre, the same place, the chamber of crime. I realized, by the way, that you use the word chambre very, very often.
And I do?
Oh, yes, all the time.
I didn't realize.
Yeah, you do. Yeah. And it's lovely because you don't use it always adequately, I should say. No?
Tout à fait possible.
Because for you, everything is a chambre. So you tell me you'll be in this chambre and then you'll go to this chambre. It's beautiful. And of course, I think it's most important because you're right to feel that there are chambres. So let me say a few words about chambre because this is also writing. You know that La Recherche du Temps Perdu begins in a chambre. The opening of this huge work of art is staged in a chambre where actually everything happens. I mean, everything has happened in the first chapter of La Recherche du Temps Perdu, which will happen later in hundreds of following chapters. And it's one of the things I say in my II, that is, there is always a chambre, always. Without that chambre, nothing. One might even refer to the cavern of Plato, you know. But the chambre is such a beautiful word, and that's why I want to underline it. It is, so you say room or chamber or la chambre. We wouldn't say that in French, we would say salle. But salle. I didn't correct you. Don't. Keep it. Because chambre is most important. Chambre is camera. It's the same word. And camera is camera. It's the inside camera. I mean, you start, I mean, it's the film has started. You know, you record everything. Everything is happening. In Proust's room, the film is, as you know, running on the walls with images of the first imaginary crime of Golo and Genevieve, etc., etc. So without, I mean, of course, this is the unconscious of a text. Then we know that for Proust, for instance, things happen in his chambre. And in his chambre, in all his novel, in all his fiction, you'll find the chambre, which are actually reading chambers. What does it mean? Reading chambers, where he starts reading the future of the work, the present as passing, as being almost past and being also future, etc. And every time it's in a room, which was his bedroom of a sick boy with lots of curtains everywhere. This is one of the reasons why I wanted you to let the curtains behind me, because it's most important to have curtains. You know, you need curtains not to blind everything, but to suggest that you might open them and not. So I became aware of that. Of course, I did not start anything in my life thinking, let's take a camera or a camera or a room and write. No. It's gradually, after time and after many, many books, that looking retrospectively, I thought that everything happens in that writing or reading chamber. And in all creation, you'll find that. With different forms, and it may be sometimes surprising. And then it came to me what you said, that as I realized that in my opera, the camera is the kitchen. Why? Because those wonderful marionettes, divine goddesses, these goddesses of my childhood, or the genealogy of women who were powerful and vulnerable, going back for generations with their husbands always dead and trying to survive, things would explode in the kitchen. This, of course, is, I could say, but I don't want to formalize, it's just because I talk to you that I say that. It might be also related to my relation to women. But of course, the fact that I'm a partisan of women, the fact that I love women, is something that I received from the women of my family. Because they themselves were very heterosexual. I mean, they would never have thought that anything else than making love properly would, I mean, they couldn't even imagine that. But they were generous and courageous and humble and wonderful and deep women. And I've been brought up with this treasury. But of course, for me, it was comical. It was great. It was, again, as I say, it was, they were goddesses, but Greek goddesses. You know, the way you have, for instance, Greek goddesses or Roman goddesses, well, let's say Greek goddesses, you know, tearing their hairs and boxing each other, etc. You know, that lovely violence that the Greeks could free. So in that loving violence, I could see in the household everywhere, in a way that was not it was not humiliating. It let light come out while quarreling about pots and pans and how to peel onions, etc. Things came out, you know, because this is, it's the cooking of passions. And so I would lend an ear to that, and it was mythology at home. But it has to be in the kitchen, of course. Might have been elsewhere. I don't know if they had been in a workshop or something. I don't know. Well, it's in the kitchen. But as I say, cooking passions, well, it's that, you know. It's cooking is part of what happens with our visceral body. You see that also in a way that is sometimes burlesque in Joyce. When Bloom crosses the whole of Dublin with kidney in his pocket. So it's also a way of making, of getting rid of the dictatorship of hierarchy, of, you know, what is honorable and dignified and what is supposed to belong to the bottom of the house and society. It's a rehabilitation of everything and everybody. So coming back to your question and the native place, this I'm sure I can share with you. That is, I mean, with everybody here, that is the fact that we are scions. We are inheritors. We are marked. We're imprinted, impressed by the most mysterious of antecedents. That is birthplace. What is birthplace? It's not only the mother, of course. It's something that I haven't yet totally explored. The mystery of what we owe and how what we receive, what we owe. What we don't owe, the type of debt we have, or the type of demand we have on the so-called birthplace. We are books. We have been written. Then we read. We are written, then we read. And we read what has been inscribed, traces. And of course, as we know, it starts long before us. Birthplace is also the birthplace of my ancestors, and who have written me before me. On this, I keep meditating. For instance, because, as I know, I share that with so many of you, I have so many birthplaces. And I never know where I was born, you know. I'm always a bit worried when I say that I was born there, because I know that I was born there, but there, and there was there, and here, etc., etc. I know that I was born in Osnabrück, and sometimes I say my mother was born in Osnabrück. It's not true. My mother was born in Strasbourg, which was a kind of branch of Germany. I have the feeling that I was born in Osnabrück, although I was born in Oran, but I wasn't born in Oran because my birthplace in Oran was born in Morocco, which was born in Spain, etc., etc. And of course, it multiplies and divides both. The unity, which is a purely abstract concept of the self. Mm-hmm. I was born so many times and in so many ways that are sometimes irreconcilable. To this, I must say that fate added something extraordinary, I must say, and it has to do with signifiers. And it takes place in Oran, the place where I was registered as being born in Algeria. And it's like that. Where I was born, it's a a place in the center of the city, where I was born here. Here is the theater, there where you're sitting, and there is the Rathaus, the mairie. And here is the Cercle Militaire, the garden where I couldn't enter because it was forbidden to Arabs and Jews. Now, here was the shop of my grandfather who came before he was born, who came from Spain, Morocco, Algeria. And his little shop had a huge and wonderful sign printed, and it was called Les Deux Mondes. Les Deux Mondes, the two worlds, which says something of the ambition and dream of my grandmother, my grandfather who hadn't gone to school, who started working at 11. But Les Deux Mondes, and I kept thinking in my childhood, what are Les Deux Mondes, the two worlds? Which world is which and how? Is it China and India, or is it, I don't know, you know, it went on and on, because Les Deux Mondes is everything, all worlds, all two worlds, there are so many. And there you could buy everything, from postcards to confectionery, and particularly all kinds of things for military persons, so caps, belts, etc., etc. I mean, everything a soldier needs. And I'm fascinated by that, because I would read that every day, you know, Les Deux Mondes, and know that in Les Deux Mondes you can buy everything. I mean, it's a kind of ridiculous type of, but it's a beautiful thing at the same time. And also naive. And there was an annex of this shop, which was where they sold only hats coming from France. Paris hats. Bowler hats, etc., you know. And this was called Iglif. Iglif was the pride of the family. Iglif was high life, pronounced in the French way by my grandfather's family, who were so proud of having picked up in the future, you know, the shining future, two words, high life. No, Iglif. Iglif. So many languages, you know. So I was written by that. I was written by that. I was read by that. I started reading that when I was two. You know, I was looking at those signs and I thought, this is the book of the world. And I just have to read it. Coming back to birthplaces, I could say the same from in Osnabrück. I mean, there's something parallel as rich and funny and deep. So, who writes? When I write, who writes? I don't know. It's a choir. It's a chorus. I mean, there's so many people writing inside me. I can even feel the handwriting of my grandmothers, etc., you know, in my handwriting. Not only that, I can also feel the handwriting of my children because they participate in my writing. When I need something, mathematically speaking, which I very often need, that is, when I need to translate into mathematics a certain type of mysterious syntax, I ask my son, who is a mathematician. 59 comes from him, as I said, you know, I don't steal, I recognize the debt, you know. I call him and I said, what's 59? You know, what is 59? Because I feel, I have found out 59, it's everywhere. So I think, but 59 has something to tell me. I'm sure it's mathematics, but these mathematics are mathematics of the soul. So I call the mathematician, you know, of the family. And he said, 59 is, so I said, stop, please, don't go too fast. And he starts dictating to me things that I cannot reproduce because it would take hours, you know, the mystery of 59. Now, maybe I'm born of my son. In the moment when I work on 59, he gives me a kind of life. The other mystery is, of course, that if I don't know where I was born, what I know is that we're not going to die where we were born. And the death place is for me an immense source of, I could say, I don't want to say mourning, but almost desire. Desire and despair, because I don't know about that. I don't know. I have the experience, again, that I share with you of having all kinds of death places. For instance, the father of my mother, who was Austro-Hungarian when he was born, became German in order to marry my grandmother, who was German. And as a German, he enrolled in the First World War, was killed as a German soldier in Baranovichi, in Belorussia, and I always thought about that, you know, about that fate of this little man falling somewhere up north. So, buried, forgotten, there are pictures of it. But our death place, and I have death places where my beloved are buried, are like birth places beyond, beyond death. All this is material for writing, which is, after all, a way of unburying, burying and unburying.
Maybe I could explore this connection a bit further through another theme that appears in Benjamin Hamilton in a Foucault deal, and which I believe also runs into Oi and Aye. The theme of a dangerous invitation, which is exactly the return of your mother and aunt, or of the figures of Selma and Jenny, to their birthplace, Osnabrück. And I want to quote another sentence from Benjamin Amontaigne, which maybe shows how close together birthplace and deathplace can be, even though you said, of course, geographically, we do not necessarily die where we are born, but there might be connections. So I would like to quote the following sentence uttered by one of these two female deity figures in Benjamin Amontaigne. On nous a invités au théâtre de notre mise à l'ombre. We were invited to the theater of our own. How would you say that, Helene? How would you translate that?
I think, unfortunately, it's idiomatic. And,
it's idiomatic, exactly.
Yeah, it's so, I think it can't be translated. I would say incarcerated or something. But mise à l'ombre is beautiful because it uses a metaphor in French. It means putting something into prison.
Yes.
In the shadow. I don't know, translators, what would you say?
There are enough translators here. What would you say? Mise à l'ombre, how would you translate?
It's untranslatable, unfortunately. It's beautiful in French. And also we use ombre as shadow, but also for the shadows in Hades.
The question that I would like to ask following this untranslatable passage, if we can think of Oi, which relates of this kind of return to Osnabrück following the dangerous invitation, if we can think of Oi as the shout of literature or the literary shout of this earlier shadow play to which your figures were invited.
Maybe you could add your question, Eric, because it would, you know, the question three. Thank you.
I was planning on doing question two.
S'il te plaît, parle plus fort, sinon je te tape.
This is only the second time you've come to Israel. 2 weeks ago, you went for the first time as an adult to Osnabrück, the German town in which your mother grew up. What is the significance of the seemingly delayed journeys? What about your return to Algeria, which was also, in some sense, delayed? The Algerian theme appears explicitly in your writing many years after your departure. For example, in your Rêverie la femme sauvage, The Reveries of the Wild Woman, I believe it was translated in English, which was published in 2000. Similarly, your eponymous book, Osnabrück, published in 1999, presents itself as a risky, delayed return in your fiction to your mother's history.
I think that I'm going to say something very, very banal, and at the same time, I think essential. It's that invitations are dangerous. I have always had a terrible relation to invitations, but I must say that now it has become the subject of a beautiful little book of Derrida, which is called Passion, and where he tries to operate the secrets of invitation as immediately triggering the feeling of obligation, which of course relates to the theme of giving, of debt, etc., etc., which you may guess already how it can work out. That if you want to have a theoretical approach to dangerous invitation, there you have it. Now, if you want to practice dangerous invitation, then it's all up to what happens in your lives. And what I first witnessed when indeed my mother and her sister became the prey of a dangerous invitation, which was rooted in the history of Germany as it has become the consequence of Nazism. And in a very concrete situation, the fact that Osnabrück, the city of my mother's family, made what happens in Germany regularly, not everywhere, but very, very often, an effort to, of course, not to reconcile, this is a South African concept, but to accept the memory and consequences of having had all it's her, or I don't know what gender to use, Jews expelled and deported. So the city of Osnabrück eventually, and in reality, came to doing that job of, if I can say so, purification, which is endless, of course, it has no end. And then it happens in the life of my two goddesses that they receive a mail from the Rathaus of Osnabrück telling them that they're looking for their surviving Jews, 10 persons out of the community, which they spotted in the world, and invite them. So I was there when I saw my goddesses thinking about it and wondering whether they should go back to Osnabrück, where there are so many traces and so many, and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of extraordinary stories that happened in Osnabrück with the different people, and of which I knew almost everything. I can put myself in their place. What can I do? What is fair? What should be done? What can be done? Everything, of course, is immediately it becomes apolitic. You cannot. You must do what you cannot do, etc. And no one can interfere. I was just watching. Until something happens. And then there is a decision. You don't know, you're not going, you go. There. Why aren't you going? Oh, that's... Then you have to write books in order to explain why you're not going. But then you have to write other books to explain why you go, etc. That's for me, but if I am two, for instance, two sisters, it becomes infinite, you know, because when one is about to decide, the other goes backward. When one says, and then when they decide, then it's your fault. You said that. No, I? No, no, no. You said that. You wanted to go to that hotel. I don't want to go to... You asked, etc. So it's, you know, it's a kind of extraordinary play of... what a decision is and a dangerous invitation is. Now, why is it dangerous? You can lose so much, but you don't. But then, what is it that you will lose? That is immeasurable. The comfort, particularly the comfort of not having to decide, the comfort of not having to face a new type of feelings, the comfort of not being driven to so-called forgive or forget, or you know, I mean, it's immense what you can lose, but everything you lose, of course, you gain. I witnessed that, and then my two goddesses went to Osnabrück and came back. I could write so many plays on this small event, and also additional plays. For instance, so what happens inside? Which is not something that happens in a simple and definitive way, because it then with time it will move all the time, change forms, bring surprises. For instance, my going to Osnabrück, and then of course things happen. For instance, Osnabrück comes forth, a city with its huge history, beginning with Karl der Große, the founding emperor, and with the Treaties of Westphalen, which was the beginning of peace in Europe, And Osnabrück calls itself the city of peace, as Jerusalem. Mm? You know, cities of peace are always dangerous. And then also, so you have all the German history, which is beautiful and very interesting. It's the place in Osnabrück and Münster, it's the twin city, where Catholics and Protestants, first of all, burnt one another, then reconciled. Okay. And then you have the history of these Christian entities and the Jews. And then you have the Jews in Osnabrück. Thousands of, I mean, centuries of Judaity of all kinds. And then the total disappearance of the former Jews who had been there for a very, very long time. And their replacement, that's of course the surprise. The replacement by imported Jews, because there are no Jews, so you import Jews made in Russia. So you have imported Jews in Osnabrück who don't speak a word of anything, of course, and who start trading in Russian. I mean, you know, everything. It's an image. It's an image of what happens everywhere with destruction, then reviving, reintroducing this vanished species, the extinction of species, etc., etc. So. And then all that happens in the little bodies and the great lives of my two tiny goddesses, who suspect everything, who smell everything, who discuss everything in the kitchen, and of course their interpretation is something that I owe them, because you have to be so unarmed to receive the blows of powerful history, you know. So that's something that they gave me. I was looking at what was happening in their beings, the transformation. So dangerous invitation, but that's for me, you know. Because you invited me here.
I know.
Yeah. And she told me on the phone, I was surprised that you accepted. Why did you accept? So I told her the truth. I accepted because I wanted not to accept. I accepted because I felt at first that I didn't want to accept. I didn't want to accept because, I mean, just like my goddesses, you know, laziness, and something I very often reproach myself, I think, you're a coward, because, you know, I know what's going to happen. That is, I don't know what's going to happen. What I know is that it's I'll have to give up all kinds of ready-made feelings, thoughts, etc., etc., and change things, and I recognize that in me. But of course, the moment I don't want to do something, I do it. Mm? Otherwise, I wouldn't write. Mm? So it's all dangerous, you know. And of course, ever since, as I said, so I must, have you ever been in Israel? Yes, but it's not true. You know, I've been here with the Théâtre du Soleil. And that was, I think it was in 87, you know, it wasn't in 88. I don't remember the year exactly.
Google says 88, but that might just
not
mean nothing.
It's impossible, because in 88 we were working on something else, so it must be 87.
No, you were not working on that play, but it was at the Jerusalem Festival of 88, the plays of 87. It was
well,
on
maybe.
The Festival of 88.
Well, then it's true. Okay. Then it's 88, yeah. But thank God I was, my mother and my aunt and her sister were there too. Also feeling that it was a dangerous invitation. But in that time I was inside the Théâtre du Soleil. I came as the playwright of the Théâtre du Soleil. We gave the Indiad, which is a play on partition. on the partition of India and Pakistan, a metaphor of what could happen in Israel. And also we came in very special conditions because the company is large. At that time, maybe there were 30 players, I don't know. And among them, there were five or six Muslims from different countries. There was an Indian, there was a Tunisian, there were two Algerians, etc., etc. And all of them had to decide whether they wanted to go to Israel or not. So since it's a kind of democracy, everybody voted and explained, etc. So that's it. So I don't consider that I came to Israel. I came with the Théâtre du Soleil, with our own type of adventure and political relation to places, because the Théâtre du Soleil is very political. And responsibility was shared. You know, we were 60 maybe here. And ever since I didn't come. You know, and I never refused coming. But the fact that I was not invited is also something that I want to emphasize. Because I suspect many things behind that. So, of course, when Carola asked me, and I love Carola, I had met her, I said yes. It didn't mean that I said a beautiful, sunny, shining yes. But from the heart, yes. Then from the mind, etc., etc., and... it's complicated because, and of course the because is multiple. Part of the because is it's my of course my political positions, how I feel about but Israel is not only Israel. I mean, there are many Israels, of course, and inside Israels or outside, I don't know. So many types, I mean, thousands of different Judaities, you know, and I resist ferociously against the tendency everywhere, in France, everywhere, of saying Jews, you know. Jews as if there was one Jew, you know, a kind of general Jew, or a general Judaism, which is ridiculous. I resist here, too, you know, that is, imagining, for instance, that... one could simplify the situation. No, it's complicated, and it has to be even more complicated. But I know that one of the because that is a personal, strictly personal complication is my being born in Algeria and having lived a situation which has hurt me deeply and forever, and that was the colonization, the French colonization, which I cursed and still curse in Algeria. And the fact that in the decisive years of my life, I saw what empires would inflict on what they, I mean, the idea of a colonial empire, of colonization, is something that I think is one of the most incredible excess of power in history. And the problem is that now we try to recognize, I mean, the international community tries to recognize genocide. And you know how it's difficult for everybody to come to terms with the idea that there has been an Armenian genocide, and what about the Rwanda? And then there are some people here or elsewhere who think that there's one primal genocide, which is the so-called Holocaust, which I never call Holocaust and never show up because when I lived it as a kid, it wasn't called like that. You know, it was something that happened in all the families around, and which was nameless, which couldn't be gathered in one signifier, but had millions of names, as of course one sees in monuments. So what I saw in Algeria every day of my life, and I could have howled, you know, when I saw that. I was persecuted. We were persecuted as Jews. And And there, if I can say so, they were more persecuted than us. And that was the who we called the Arabs, because we didn't even name them properly. You know, les Arabes. And I suffered for that, for them, for me, etc. In a way that I can't ever attenuate. You know, it comes back again and again. And for me, the only the next chapter, if I can say so, is something that is natural, that has come naturally. It hasn't been forced. The fact that after so many years of I left Algeria. My mother didn't go. Forgive me if I give some details. My mother did not leave Algeria when the French were expelled. In 1962, when Algeria finally became independent, my mother stayed because she had become a midwife, and she was the midwife for Les Arabes. She put into the world 3,000 or 4,000 little Arab babies. So she stayed because she was youthful, and she stayed until she was expelled in 24 hours in 1972. She was given a day to leave Algeria. That is part of a kind of history which is not told ever, because it's a shame. So it was her second time being expelled from a country. First Germany, which she fled. I mean, she went out by herself. And then Algeria, she was kicked out. I could go back to Algeria as the person I am. I have always been against the French colonizers, always. And I'm the minority regarding that. I have never been able to share feelings with the French who considered Algeria as their thing, you know. But, of course, so I rejected the French position, but I wasn't, of course, admitted by the Algerians who mistook me for a French, which I have never been. So I couldn't explain that to them, you know. When we were staying, we were, you know, face to face in the garden that my father cared for so that we could eat, because he couldn't work. He had been ejected out of the French nationality. We were standing with our hands on the bars with the little yaouleds there, and me here, face to face, and I wanted to explain to them, I am you, but they, for them, I wasn't them, you know. It was impossible. Of course, there are exceptions. Mm-hmm. There are exceptions, but very, very rare. So after the independence, I never thought I would go back to Algeria, because then they had their own history, which was unfortunately biased, became awful. It's a military regime. Under the mask of a kind of democracy, of course it's undemocratic, although it's less undemocratic than other Arab countries, because women still have possibilities that they don't have in neighbor countries. They go to the university, they don't have to wear the veil, although they more and more, of course, they are putting it on, etc. So I thought, as long as they, Algerians, as long as my intellectuals in Algeria who were forming themselves slowly, don't do the work that I think one has to do, that is, criticize yourself, criticize the country. The thing that hurt me when in my Jewish family, they would say, don't say anything bad against the Jews. So I said, but Jews are human, They're just as good and as bad as others. They kill, it's just the same. No, don't, because you're going to hurt the Jews, you know. So it's the same thing happened in Algeria. And I thought, I'm not going to do that game again, as long as the Algerians are obliged, which I could understand. The new intellectuals in Algeria, I knew that they knew. I knew that they thought that the regime was awful, that it became, that it was totally corrupt, etc., you know. But of course they would never say it. Not to a non-Algerian, between themselves, yes, but openly, no. And eventually it happened that they started speaking, but it happened very late. It was in the 90s. And it happened because they started being killed, you know. That was what they call in Algeria les années noires, the black years. For 10 years they were massacred, you know, by the Islamist terrorists. And so they fled to France. They arrived, and for the first time in my life, I started having a real friendship with Algerians. We started loving each other as if we were recovering something that we had never had, you know. And so now, of course, this is long ago. Now I have around me so many friends who come from Algeria, not only Algeria, but Algeria again. I have ties with Algeria. And also I have developed a quantity of friendly relations with intellectuals and writers and artists from different Arab countries. And for us, it's a treasure. And I know that it's important that one of my best friends is a great Iraqi writer, a woman, great Iraqi writer who lives now in Paris, but she's a refugee, really. So my friends from Egypt or Syria, or everyone has to do a certain work of basically also information. There is understanding the background history of others, which is always repressed or unknown, etc. So, it's as if we were having what we have here, I'm sure, in Israel, as if we were trying to weave a tiny, tiny, tiny country of solidarity, of understanding, of course, of tolerance, etc. I mean, the future, faraway future. So, coming to Israel, of course, when I told my Iraqi friend, whose name is Alia Mamdou, a remarkable writer, she came to me a couple of days before I came here. I said, I'm going to Israel. She said, please bring back something to me from Jerusalem. I mean, and I thought it was funny because I had to teach her what Israel is. She's a genius, really. But you know, 10 or 15 years ago, I had to explain to her what had the history of Jews in centuries in different countries, because she didn't understand. She's a remarkable person, and she told me, I don't understand Israel. So many people have told me that, and it's true that they don't. It's not that they reject. Which is sometimes the attitude that you find very currently in France. They reject. They are Israelophobe. No, very often it's really an incredible, an unimaginable ignorance. So I started being a kind of pilgrim of, you know, explaining what is now taught in French schools, which wasn't before. In French schools, they, when they're 12 or 13, they learn about Nazism, they learn about anti-Semitism, about colonization, etc. At least they hear about it. But before, you know, no one heard about that. It's very recent. I even thought, if it had been possible, I would have asked Alia to come with me here. But she can't. She's Iraqi, she has no papers, etc., etc.
First of all, thank you very much, Hélène. And we would like to give time for some questions, which perhaps in view of the pressure of time, we would like to collect, and then Hélène could answer together. Would that be fine, Hélène?
Yeah,
okay,
of course.
Okay, fabulous. Mm. So please go ahead.
Thank you. Yesterday, towards the last part of your talk, there was this part about masculine warriors and princes begging to be remembered and begging their friends to bear their name and their memory in literature. And then in Oi, there is this counterpart of two Jewish women quarreling in their kitchen about the ownership over memories and stories. No, this is my memories, you can't tell it. This is, I am a better teller than you are, or I know your memories best. And I would like to hear your thoughts about this opposition between two different views of bearing the memory or owning a story, testifying for someone.
Of course, I can only say that memories is also something that it's a kind of impalpable treasure, which will certainly cause more, you know, because. As you know, it's very
accept the other memory, either for the same event. Now, this is not true. This is how it happened. You know, it's the fragile ground of historians. So, I think that it's too. I mean, memory is totally subjective. It's my memory. Made up by me, because of course it's a mixture of what I remember, what I imagine. It's partly fictitious, etc., and it's made up. But what you were pointing to is, I'm sure something that just to refer to something concrete, without any kind of judgment. In France, for instance, there is somebody who has done a film that you certainly know about, that's Shoah, that's Lanzmann. And Lanzmann is a powerful man who has a feeling that he is the owner of a kind of a God design owner of a certain type of memory of the Shoah, you know. And I have no feelings regarding him, except that I consider him as exemplary. That is, for him, it's his, you know. He can't bear when somebody else comes and does something in the same field, or, you know. It makes him outraged, you know. But I think that what he expresses is something very current. I'm sure that there are strange feelings of jealousy that creep, you know, in all consciences regarding the who is the legitimate owner of this or that event. That's why I say it's a matter of reflection for historians. It's their problem too, how you write history. As regards the example of that I quoted of the Ajax dying and saying, remember me, or Hamlet dying saying, remember me. This, of course, is that's the hero is us. It's really the feeling, it's the wonderful feeling of everybody who dies. Will you remember me?
Okay. We will collect now, okay? Please, go ahead.
I wanted to ask about Paul Celan.
and the cost of literature?
Last night you spoke about Fintan. He wrote a poem about a dark hour of clock. I felt that it told for him in a way. I wonder if for Turan, for him, there was no salvation in literature. He wrote beautifully, but he was like Eurydice, you know? He fell back into Sheol, and we grieve him. And yet you survived literature. So I want to know, how did you survive literature when Portugal did not? And what was the cost? Because I feel there's a cost.
Next couple questions, please. Thank you.
So first, thank you. And I wanted to ask about probably the relationship between literature and violence or literature in the world. And you spoke about writing and literature as a retreat from a violent world. And I was wondering about how is literature about or of the world, and how is it separate and a retreat from the world? And where
it's not. I shall tell you immediately. It's not. It can't be about or
So I would love to hear more about
it.
Okay,
yeah.
Please, Lina.
I would like to ask about the question of authorship, perhaps, which came up yesterday a lot, and also today. Yesterday I felt that there was very much, there was the kind of the multiplicity of literary authors in which one embeds one's own writing, or in which one's own writing is really embedded. So there is not one original author forever, really. Not one genius, but you're really embedded in many traditions. And today, everyone spoke about the multiplicity of places of birth and death, so it comes up there as well. How at the same time, I mean, surely there is at the same time some kind of search for voice in all of this. What is the tension here? Can we somehow formulate it?
Odelia.
Thank you. Maybe just to your question, you mentioned the split, kind of between the two boxes as a source of liturgy.
Okay, one last question, please.
Yesterday you mentioned that through writing and reading, one can feel, one can see, one trembles, so my emotions are really very, very physically there, possibly. And that you have a visual artist who come to you and ask for your help, or who wants to work with you because they feel that they're lacking something that you have. I wonder whether you could explain a bit more about what do you think you bring to these visual artists to your work?
Okay.
I'm sorry that we cannot accept more questions. I hope that's okay with you. Thank you.
I can't say anything regarding Ceylon because, I mean, he's a single person and somebody who... He's not the only person who suffered beyond suffering. As you know, Nelly Zaks also suffered in the same way. So these are extreme cases. So I think that usually the moment you write, you're saved, you know. The moment you write, you don't kill yourself. It's a paradox. You may want to kill yourself. You may want to make an end of something. But if in your hand the pen still moves, you don't do it. That's the mystery. So you can't say anything about that. So literature is linked with survival, but survival is linked with dying. You die and you resurrect, but the same thing if you lose somebody who is yourself. And as Proust says, you know, how is it possible, as Dostoevsky says, how is it possible that I survive what makes me die? That's life. So I can't say anything about that except that. We don't know about what happens to this man, Celan. It has nothing to do with... it's not the fault of literature. Maybe literature went to sleep for 1 second. That was a fatal second. I don't know. It doesn't mean, again, that you're not attracted by death, because you are. As regards a retreat from violence, now, let me be very clear. A literature that is not violent is nothing. I mean, the only thing that is important for us is how to deal, how to name things that we can't bear even to think. And literature is there for that, to help us find poetically a kind of response to what we can't live without feeling totally lost and voiceless. It's finding a voice for the voiceless. So it's never without. I mean, I can't even imagine that. It's never. It would be no use, but doesn't exist. It always deals with the worst. It is the worst. It has to do with the worst. And the worst, I must say. So now, to come back to the fact that we inherit, the worst is always new. It wouldn't be the worst if it weren't new, because then we would get used to it. We would see a certain type, for instance, of torches, etc., burning witches or whatever. We would get used to it. But the evil or the devil or whatever will invent new worsts. And literature is there to try and depict and receive and react to those new inventions of the worst. So it's never without violence, never. As regards what you said, that is the fact that there is this succession or the embedded theme. First of all, you're quite right to ask. I want to underline that, because in France, for instance, very often I see so many writers who haven't read a book in their life, you know, and they call themselves writers. For me, this is out. I'm not interested, you know, because it's almost ridiculous. I mean, you know, writing is a kind of it's also a science of memory. Or it's an art of memory. You do remember and have received the gift, that is the poison, of so many before you. If you come after Shakespeare without having read Shakespeare, I mean, and this is very current. I must say most of what is published in France is of that time. You know, they invent. You know, they invent the table, they invent the pen, or you know. No. We are memory keepers, or we are keepers of flames and ashes. And then, of course, comes the question, since, as I said, it's always the same in a different way. It's you take Greek tragedy, you have all the different instances of what men can do to men, you know, cutting children to pieces, making a stew of them, etc., eating a ragout of children. You have everything. And then you have differences. I mean, as I said, history invents new forms. And you yourself, each writer is a new form of the same tradition of horror for which we are responsible. The unique voice, for me, it's always something very, it's very mysterious. Mm-hmm. But you immediately distinguish the voice. It's the voice of a musician or a painter. It's exactly the answer you have it in music. How is it that with the same notes of music you have, I don't know, Beethoven or or Monteverdi, I don't know, you know. It's the uniqueness has to do with the mystery of the signature. It's the signature. It's the creation, the creature, the writing creature that you are. You've been created, and you've been created, that writing creature has been created by so many, and this, of course, I cannot account for that, but so many over-determination. There are so many threads that have to be have to come into contact and merge in order to give a signature. But for this, I cannot account. I cannot account for the ear of a composer. But if it's not unique, it doesn't exist. And it must be recognizable as absolutely unique, even if the contents are always the same. As for visual art, it's simply the fact that what I pointed to, which I wouldn't know without if I weren't told or asked, is the fact that I do realize that artists have a need to be accompanied. They need a translation. They need a reader, and probably readers are very, very, very rare. They need people who can read what they're doing without knowing what they do, because artists don't know what they do, and writers don't know what they do. So they need readers who will give them back what they have done, and that has no name. And so they ask you to name it.
Okay, thank you very much. I would first of all like to thank you, Hélène, and also you, Eric, for taking part in this conversation on forgiving so generously. And I would like to thank all of you for being there. Thank you.